हेलो चिल्ड्रन, दिस इज़ द फोर्थ लेक्चर ऑफ क्लास सेवेंथ हिस्ट्री चैप्टर 3 दिल्ली सुल्तान। इन द लास्ट लेक्चर वी डिस्कस अबाउट द एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन ऑफ दिल्ली सुल्तान। इन दिस लेक्चर ऑल्सो वील डिस्कस मोर अबाउट एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन ओनली। ओके, एज आई टोल्ड यू ड्यूरिंग मिडवेल पीरियड एग्रीकल्चर वॉज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट। वाई इट वॉज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट? बिकॉज from agriculture only the king collect taxes, and from that tax only they manage their kingdom. So these lands were given to the peasants, the lands which was like captured by some Iltutmish or another ruler, that these lands were given to the peasant and agriculture was encouraged. After that we discuss about the internal and external frontier. So we are talking about the internal frontier only. So in interior part of the his kingdom, internal frontier means interior part of his kingdom. So in interior part of his kingdom, new fortress, garrison town and towns were established to protect trade routes and to promote regional trade. As we discuss about the Firoz Shah Tughlaq, when he became the ruler, what he did, he made new cities, near about 300 new cities he made. Why he made? So that he can promote this trade and regional trade and routes. Okay, the second expansion occurred along the external frontier. So these two expansion were there. One was in internal of his interior part of his kingdom, another is external frontier means on the borders. As we discuss scheme, Mongols attacks were there during this period of time. So to protect themselves from Mongols attack, what they did, they fortified border area also, and they kept military over, means soldiers were kept there so that they could be protected from there. So another expansion was external frontier during the reign of Alauddin Khalji and culminated with the Muhammad Tughlaq. You can see that Alauddin Khalji was one ruler and the first ruler who campaigned towards southern part. Before Alauddin Khalji, you will not find that any ruler was there who attacked in the southern part. They were attacking to another kingdom, but it was in the northern part only. The first ruler who attacked in the southern part was Alauddin Khalji. After Alauddin Khalji, you will find Muhammad bin Tughlaq also attacked in the southern part. So in their campaign, when they campaigned towards southern part or another kingdom, what they used to get? They captured elephants, horses, slaves and carried away precious metals also. So one difference you can find between Alauddin Khilji and Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Alauddin Khilji, when he campaigned towards south, so he only collected these things, horses, elephants and precious material, and they left that kingdom to their ruler only as his subordinate. Not means he was not ruling directly there. But when Muhammad bin Tughlaq campaigned there, so he captured the area and started and became the ruler of that part. So that's why you will find that after the Muhammad bin Tughlaq, because it became a large area, as you can see in this map, earlier this whole area was under the Delhi Sultan. And only Kashmir and Odisha was not under them, but maximum part and Rajasthan part also, some part were not under the Delhi Sultan, but maximum part of the northern area was under the Delhi Sultan. And Alauddin Khilji, what he did, he campaigned to the south part also, but he not started ruling over. Muhammad bin Tughlaq, when he campaigned to the southern part, he started ruling over there. So his kingdom became very large. In Delhi Sultan, you will find that whose kingdom was very large, it was Muhammad bin Tughlaq only. But after him, you will find that it will start declining. Why it will start declining? Because it is not very easy to control a vast area. So that's why Alauddin Khilji only, he has collected the precious material but not started ruling, and Muhammad bin Tughlaq, what he did, he became the ruler only. So this was there. So by the end of Muhammad bin Tughlaq reign, 150 years after somewhat humble beginning, the army of the Delhi Sultan had marched across a large part of subcontinent. They had defeated rivals army and seized cities. As I told you, they seized the city only. The Sultanate collected taxes from the peasantry and dispensed justice in the realm. So wherever they captured, they started collecting taxes. And if they are not controlled or they made them subordinate of the king, so they were collecting taxes only from that vast area. Okay. Now, as we discussed, Khomeini mosque was made during that period of time. So what is mosque? Mosque is a masjid in Arabic where the Muslim people pray to the God. Okay. And as we discussed about the Quwwat al-Islam, it was made by the Qutbuddin Aibak. And after that, you will find this in this mosque was enlarged by Iltutmish and Alauddin Khilji made their Alai Darwaja. That is very important. The Minar was built by two Sultan. This Qutub Minar was made by two Sultan. One is Qutbuddin Aibak and another is Iltutmish. And I told you that Firoz Shah Tughlaq has repaired that. Okay. Now, a closer look at administration and consolidation under the Khalji and Tughlaq. As I told you about the administration, little more let us know about them. Consolidation means how they control over. The consolidation of a kingdom as vast as the Delhi Sultan needed reliable governor, isn't it? As we discussed, as we have seen in the map, it was a very large area. So, to control over, we need, or Delhi Sultanate need governor. As you can compare with this period, of present period of time, as central government is there, so they appoint governors on all states, isn't it? In all states, the central government appoints his governors so that they can control the vast area. So same thing was done in Delhi Sultanate also. To control over, they needed reliable governors and administration rather than appointing aristocrat. Aristocrat means rich people and landed chieftain as governor. The early Delhi Sultanate, especially Iltutmish, favored their special slaves purchased. Understood? What is they are trying to say? Ki they were not appointing the aristocrat. Aristocrat means whoever the rich people, Amir and Malik, were there in their court. So they were not appointing governor to them. Especially Iltutmish, what he wanted that his slave, whoever he has purchased as a slave, the slave only he appointed as a governor. Why? Because they trust more on slave than their relatives or son. So these slaves were known as Bandigan in Persian. So they were carefully trained to man some of them, most important political officer in that only Balban was also there. So Iltutmish has made the one department only, Turkane Chehlgami. In that 40 slaves groups were there, and that 40 groups of slaves who became governors in different area. So since they were totally dependent upon their master, the Sultan could trust and rely upon them. Now let us find out why this very they trust on them, slave rather than son. The Sultan were advised. This advice is given by someone else. A slave whom one has brought up and promoted must be looked after, for it needs a whole lifetime and good luck to find a worthy and experienced slave. Wise men have said that a worthy and experienced slave is better than a son. So they compare that slave is better than a son. As you can see example also, after Qutbuddin Aibak, his slave Iltutmish became ruler. Though he was also his son-in-law, means Qutbuddin Aibak's daughter is married to Iltutmish, but then also he was the slave only earlier. So he trust on slave rather than his son. The Khalji and Tughlaq continued to use Bandigan, not only Iltutmish. Khalji and Tughlaq also continued to use Bandigan. Bandigan means slave, and also raised people of humble birth who were often their clients. So clients were also like their relatives, who were not very rich. They were also raised or given important post in his court. So they were appointed as general and governor. As I told you, to control over vast area, they needed governors, and these clients and slaves were appointed as a governor. However, this also introduced an element of political instability. After that, it also created instability, as you will see that if the new king become, then what about the old slaves? Because the new king himself has brought many slaves, whenever they are capturing the other area, to the people who captured, they were like they were treated as a slave only. The earlier kings also slaves were there, and new slaves were also there. So because of that only it created instability. Slaves and clients were loyal to their master and patrons, but not to their heirs. Reliable or loyal will be there to their master only, not to their heir, means they are not to their son and daughter. New Sultan had their own servants. As a result, the accession of a new monarch often saw conflict between the old and new nobility or slaves. The patronage of these humble people by Delhi Sultan also shocked many cities and authors. Persian Tuareg criticized the Delhi Sultan for appointing low and base born to high offices. So you will see that whoever Tuareg were who wrote about history. So whoever were there, maximum criticized to the king, they are appointing slave as a high position. Now, officials of Sultan Muhammad Tughlaq. Let us see whom he appointed. Sultan Muhammad Tughlaq appointed Aziz Kumar, a wine distiller, Firoz Hazam, a barber, Manka Tabak, a gardener, Ladda and Pira to high administrative post. These were means like a slave only. Ziyadun Barni, a mid 14th century chronicle, means he was writer only that period of time, reported their appointment as a sign of the Sultan's loss of political judgment and his incapacity to rule. So when these people were appointed as a high position, so this created instability, and for that only this Ziyadun Barni has criticized him. Like the early Sultan, the Khalji and Tughlaq monarch appointed military commander as governor of territories varying sizes. These lands were called iktad, as we discussed in the last lecture. What they did, they have given lands to the soldiers so that they could collect their salary from that land. And the owner of the iktad were known as iktidar or mukti. The duty of muktis was to lead military campaign and maintain law and order in their iktas. So if this iktas means the land, if these were given, so what they have to do? They have to maintain the law and order. In exchange for their military service, the muktis collected revenues of their assignment as a salary, as we discussed. So they also paid their soldiers from this revenue. So in one governor only was there, so who was having more soldiers in his army. So to his army also the muktis or iktidar has to give salary. So from that land only they were giving salary to their soldiers who were under the muktis or iktidar. Control over muktis was most effective if their office was not inheritable. As I told you, Balban, what he did, he transformed the iktidar from one place to another place. Why? Because to make it more effective. So these harsh conditions of service were rigorously imposed during the reign of Alauddin Khalji and Muhammad bin Tughlaq. Accountants were appointed by the state to check the amount of revenue collected by the muktis. That also we discussed. Care was taken that the mukti collected only the taxes prescribed by the state, and that he kept the required number of soldiers. So for that also I told you, Balban has appointed one official only so that he could see that whatever is prescribed. What was prescribed? I told you kharaj. Kharaj was the land of peasant. From there only whatever production is done, that certain amount was given to the ruler. So that certain amount was 1/3 maximum time, and when Alauddin Khilji became ruler, it was 1/2. It means 50% he was collecting. So as the Delhi Sultan brought the inherited in hinterland of the cities under their control, they forced the landed chieftain, the Samantas, aristocrat and rich landlords to accept their authority. As I told you, whenever they campaigned to another area, what they used to do, they captured the area, and whoever Samantas were there, they forced to them, they will become under the existing ruler. Under Alauddin Khilji, the state brought the assessment and collected of land revenue under its own control. So whole market control was under the ruler only when Alauddin Khilji became ruler. So whole market price was decided by Alauddin Khilji only, and this made his reign very prosperous because he wanted to keep soldiers, more and more soldier, he wanted to keep, though he has to give more and more salary he needed. So for them, what he did, he controlled over market. No one was allowed to sell their product without the knowledge of Alauddin Khilji. So he made many improvement in the markets, and his market policy is praised by all the historians. So in his name, why he wanted to control? Because he has to keep more and more soldiers. Why soldiers? Because during that period of time, more and more Mongols attacks were there, and for them, to protect them, he needed more and more soldier. And soldiers, how they will live? When they will get salary? And he has only started giving salary as a cash to the soldiers first time. Okay, before this, what was, they were given iktas, but Alauddin Khilji, what he did, he has given salary in cash. But the right of local chieftain to levy taxes were cancelled, and they were also forced to pay taxes. The Sultan administrators measured the land and kept a careful account. The first time the land was measured under the Sultan, means Alauddin Khilji only. Before this, whatever, they were only estimating the production. But Alauddin Khilji, what he did, he measured the land, and after that he imposed the taxes. Some of the old chieftains and landlords served the Sultan as revenue collector and assessor. There were three type of taxes on cultivation, as we discussed, kharaj, and amounting to about 50% of the peasant to produce. It was 50% under whose reign? When Alauddin Khilji was ruling. Before this, the rulers were taking only 30% or 25-30% only. Another new tax what he has introduced on cattle and on houses, as I told you, we discussed in the last lecture. It is important to remember that large part of subcontinent remained outside the control of Delhi Sultan. It was difficult to control distant provinces like Bengal from Delhi, and soon after annexing southern India, the entire region became independent. As they captured, as I told you, Muhammad bin Tughlaq, he captured the southern part, but as he came back to the northern part, the southern part people pretended that they are independent, and they became independent. So this problem continuously they faced. Even in the Gangetic Plain, there were forested area that Sultan forced could not penetrate. So in forested area also they were not having control over. Local chieftains established their rule in these regions. Sometimes rulers like Alauddin Khilji and Muhammad Tughlaq could force their control in these areas, but only for a short duration. Because these two rulers were very powerful, so they could control for some period of time. As their ruler changed, or after the Alauddin Khilji, these area, the forested area, the local people, they became independent only. So these problems were there with the rulers. Now see about chieftains and their fortification. As we discuss about internal frontier and external frontier, let us see more about them. Ibn Battuta, a 14th century traveler, came from Morocco. He came in the court of मोहम्मद बिन तुगलक. ही केम इन 1333 मीन 1333 एडी ही केम एंड दैट पीरियड ऑफ टाइम हु वॉज द रूलर. मोहम्मद बिन तुगलक वॉज द रूलर. ही केम फ्रॉम द मोरक्को अफ्रीका एंड एक्सप्लेन दैट चीफटेन्स समटाइम फोर्टिफाइड देमसेल्व इन माउंटेन्स इन रॉकी एंड एवन एंड रग्ड प्लेस एज वेल एज ग्रूव्स. इन इंडिया द बॉम्बू इज नॉट हॉलो, इट इज बिग, इट्स सेवरल पार्ट्स आर सो इंटरवाइंड. मीन्स ही इज डिस्क्राइब अबाउट द एवरी थिंग वट एवर ही हैज सीन इन during the reign of Muhammad bin Tughlaq, the fortified area, the palaces, the people, the society during that period of time, forest area, everything, whatever he has seen, he described. A chieftain, five in these forests, which served them as rampart, inside which are the cattle and their crops. There is also water for them within. That is rain water which collected there, as I told you, to collect the rain water. Two places were built by. One was built by the Altutmish, that is Hauze Shamsi, and one is built by the Alauddin Khilji, that is known as Hauze Khas. So about all the things Ibn Battuta has described. Let us again find out about the what is saying. The Mongols under Genghis Khan invaded Transoxiana in northeast Iran in 1219. This period of time Iltutmish was ruling, and the Delhi Sultanate faced their onslaught soon after. So that period of time when Iltutmish was ruling, the Mongols have not came in India to attack. They were known as they did many massacre in all the part wherever they attacked. It was fortunate during that period of time that they have not came to in India to attack. But when Alauddin Khilji started ruling, in his reign you will find that more Mongols attacks were there and they slaughtered many people. And this Mongol attack on the Delhi Sultanate increased during the reign of Alauddin Khilji. As I told you, in the early years of Muhammad Tughlaq rule also Mongols attacks were there. This forced the two rulers to mobilize a large standing army in Delhi, which posed a huge administrative challenge. Let us see how as Delhi was attacked twice in 1299-1300 and 1302-1303. This was the period of Alauddin Khilji. Alauddin Khilji ruled from 1296 till 1316. So as a defensive measure, Alauddin Khilji raised a large standing army, as I told you. So for that, what he did, he started giving soldiers as cash salary. Alauddin also constructed a new garrison town named Siri. So Siri was constructed by Alauddin Khilji. So for his soldiers, the soldier had to be fed. This was done through the produce collected as a tax from lands between the Ganga and Yamuna. Tax was fixed. So who has fixed this tax? Alauddin Khilji. 50%. The soldiers had to be paid. Alauddin chose to pay soldiers' salary in cash rather than iktas. The soldiers would buy their supplies from the merchants in Delhi, and it was thus feared that merchants would raise their prices. To stop this, Alauddin controlled the price of goods. As I told you, he controlled the whole market only. And price also he only fixed it. Anyone was not free to fix the price. Whatever produced, whatever products were there, all the price was fixed by the Alauddin Khilji. So prices were carefully surveyed by officers and merchants who did not sell at the prescribed rate. For that he appointed officials also to see that whatever price he estimated for the product, from that price only the people should sell or purchase. So this type of control he did so that he could get more and more money, and that money he could give to the soldier. Alauddin's administration measures were quite successful, and Chronicle praised his reign for its cheap price and efficient supplies. Why he wanted to make all the product cheap so that his soldiers could purchase at the rate, otherwise they will demand to increase their salary, isn't it? So his campaign, whatever his administration was there, Alauddin administration was successful. And if we'll compare with the Muhammad bin Tughlaq, whatever he did, That was failure. Why failure? Maximum time the people have not supported, or his idea was beyond the era. That's why. But his idea was very good. Unfortunately, it became failure. The Sultanate was attacked in the early years of Muhammad Tughlaq reign. The Mongols' army was defeated. Muhammad Tughlaq was confident about the strength of his army and resources to plan attack on Transoxiana. As I told you, he has given 1 year advance salary to the soldiers, but after that, the problem was solved and he was not supposed to attack on them. The whole salary was gone like that. So he therefore raised a large standing army. Rather than constructing a new garrison town, the oldest of the four cities, Delhi Kuna, was emptied of his resident and the soldiers garrisoned there. As I told you, he has transferred, Muhammad bin Tughlaq has transferred his capital from Delhi to Daulatabad. And what Alauddin Khilji did, he garrisoned his town, means he fortified his area. He has not left the Delhi. He fortified area to protect from attacks. So this is comparison between Muhammad bin Tughlaq and Alauddin Khilji. Now what another thing Muhammad bin Tughlaq did, produce from the same area was collected as tax to feed the army, but to meet expense maintaining such a large number of soldiers, the Sultan levied additional taxes. This coincided with famine. As I told you, when he wanted to increase the taxes, so what he did, he increased the taxes in the Doab area, and there drought occurred, and because of that famine, the people were not able to pay the taxes. So this was also failure. So Muhammad Tughlaq also paid his soldier cash salary, but instead of controlling price, he used a token currency, somewhat like present day paper currency. Token currency he has introduced, like today paper currency is there, no, likewise only he has introduced token currency, but made of cheap metals, not gold and copper metal only. The people in the 14th century did not trust these coins, and they were very smart. They saved their gold and silver coin and paid all the taxes in the state to his token currency only. So this cheap currency could also be counterfeited easily. Counterfeit means they made in their home only, and because of that, as you can say, false rupees also made by the people. So likewise, the many people have made this copper coin, and in the market more and more copper coins were there. After that, this means this done, whatever done by Muhammad bin Tughlaq to improve the condition or to preserve the gold and silver, that was failure. Administration measure, Muhammad Tughlaq's administrative measures were a failure. His campaign into Kashmir was a disaster. He then gave up his plan to invade Transoxiana and disbanded his large army meanwhile. So he has given salary and then also he has to disband it. So his administrative measures created complication. The shifting of people to Daulatabad was resented, means he has to again tell to the people to come to the Delhi. So this was also a failure. So the raising of taxes in famine, as we discussed, Ganga Yamuna belt, led to widespread rebellion, and finally the token currency had be recalled. So Alauddin Khilji and Muhammad bin Tughlaq, that was comparison between them, and in that we will find that Muhammad Tughlaq campaign was, or administration was, failure, while Alauddin Khilji was successful. Okay, so in this list of Muhammad bin Tughlaq failure, we sometimes forget that first time in the history of the Sultan, a Delhi Sultan planned to campaign to capture Mongol territory. So this was also, we should keep it in mind, the first time. Earlier what was there, only Mongols were attacking to our country, but Muhammad bin Tughlaq thought to attack on Mongols. This was also, we can see that he dare at least to attack on them. Unlike Alauddin Khilji defensive measure, Muhammad bin Tughlaq measure were conceived as a part. He wanted to control that part only, the Mongols part. So this was also a credit we should give to the Muhammad bin Tughlaq. The Sultanate in the 15th and 16th century, take a look again, you will notice that After the Tughlaq, Sayyid and Lodi dynasty ruled from Delhi and Agra until 1526. By then, Jaunpur, Bengal, Malwa, Gujarat, Rajasthan and the entire South India had independent rulers who established flourishing state and prosperous capital. This was also the period which saw the emergence of new ruling like Afghan and Rajput. During this period of time, during the Lodi period, you will see that maximum part of India were independent as they were under the Muhammad bin Tughlaq or Alauddin Khilji. After them, no powerful rulers were there. Because of that, gradually they became independent. Some of the state established in this period were small, started his career manager of a small territory of in Bihar. Mughal Emperor Humayun, like this, we will discuss about them in detail in fourth chapter when we'll discuss about the Mughal Emperor. So how this area became independent, gradually this we will discuss. So this was the in the chapter. After that, we'll continue in next lecture about Mughal dynasty. Then we will discuss about the Akbar and Jahangir, then Shahjahan, then Aurangzeb, everyone. Okay, thank you for watching.